Good morning, everybody. Come on now. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
There we go. Sometimes it takes you a couple times to get kind of loose, doesn't it? It's great to see everybody out in the house. I'm just giving you a hard time. I know everybody's sitting there socializing. You're not standing here staring at me waiting for me to say something. I get it. It's great to see everybody. We're glad you're here with us, and I hope you're ready to worship the Lord. We're going to start off with some praise songs, and then we'll have a missions moment and do a little more singing. But right now, let's start off with your name. Would you stand with us, please, and let's all praise the Lord.
Like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Jesus, in your name sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to say but your name.
You may be seated, and Shana Shepherd is going to have a missions moment for us at this time. Chastity Shepherd, both of us. Shana and Chastity, they're going to tell us more about Diamond Willow Ministries and perhaps a mission trip they were on there earlier this summer.
Just start out by saying I'm a person that doesn't like change and always like to do the same thing. Don't like to put myself out there. This is really scary for me, but like we were learning our Sunday school lesson, we're supposed to be bold and talk about Jesus and spread his word. We went to Diamond Willow this summer, and we learned a lot there. First of all, we learned that Diamond Willow was not just a church there, it was a community center. They had a new community center too that they had built for the youth to have basketball tournaments and just to reach out in different ways. They provided meals on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. They also had a food pantry that they made available on the first and last Sundays of the month that for people to come in and get food. Provided a camp for all ages during the summer to ensure that everyone can learn about Jesus, especially the youth, because that is our future. They gave to the community. They had clothing there that people would give away. They gave clothing. They had diapers. They also had Bibles, and they had Bibles for in their native tongue, too. So. Here's some pictures. Is this sunrise? Sunset, I'm sorry. Shana got to see. And then the other picture there is where we had our overnight stay with the boys that night in a campfire. Before we could actually even meet the children, we had to go. We learned a little bit about the history. We visited the Akota Lakota Museum and Culture Center, where we learned about some history we probably didn't get in our history books in school. Fort Thompson had been visited by, you know, us before, and churches, and most were Catholic churches, and they had made a lasting impression on the people there. Wasn't very good, actually. They had, you know, tried to take them out of their home and keep them and put them, Americanize them. They punished them when they talked in their native tongue. They put some lye on their arm, and some of their ancestors had those scars to prove it. They called us I'm probably not saying this right, Washitu, which is a greedy person who steals the fat, meaning that we took all the good stuff. Rob Vaughn and his wife made their goal to integrate the culture with Christian beliefs. They didn't want to take the culture from them. They wanted to add to that and show them Jesus' love. Here's some other pictures. The first one is where we're going and canvassing the area, trying to bring some of the children to church, to the camp. Most of them are out riding their bicycles and playing. It didn't look any different than it would here. They were a lot on their own. It looked more than here. We're kind of over top of our children mostly, but they're kind of out and about, riding bicycles, playing in the yard, more by themselves, not being looked after. The other picture there is Trent sitting at a table, and we're having some meals and talking to them, some snack time. And then there's one at the bottom where John's playing basketball with some boys. We got to interact a lot with the children. I know Shana does, but we think about it all the time, actually, mm-hmm. Every day. We want to go back. I wasn't even going to go, but Shana encouraged me, and then I told her if I had that week off for work, I'd go. And I actually, it was by accident, I had that week off for work.
Okay. And the basic rule is to show love. While there, we played and listened, learned about their interests, how much they love the river, and most of all, we learned about genuine love. The love the volunteers expressed and had reciprocated from the children was amazing. The staff knew where they lived, who they hung out with, and if they needed anything. And this first picture is just when we were doing activities, playing some basketball with them. And then the second picture is Trent that goes to Ford's Branch. He got into the river every day with them and let him. They bombarded him. He didn't care, though. He was really good with playing with them in the river. And don't forget our purpose. The central purpose for all Christians is to know Jesus Christ and to strive to be like him so that we can represent Jesus and offer his love, hope, and forgiveness to all.
And I encourage all of y'all, if you can, don't go to Tennessee one weekend, or don't go to the beach one week. Go on a mission trip or help send somebody.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. It's always nice when we hear individual, unique perspectives about the mission trips, and so I know you were nervous doing that, but it's much appreciated from those of us who don't get to hear, you know, all the time, the individuals that go on the trip, and you hear me and the same people up here over and over again, so it's nice to hear some fresh voices. Let's continue praising God. Would you stand with us once again? Let's sing Amazing Grace. My chains are gone. We know we're free.
Song, the Revelation song. Most of the words from this song come right from the book of Revelation. It certainly is what's going on in heaven right now, worship and praising God. Thank you.
mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
For our community meditation today, we will be looking at Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 28. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." You know, at this point in Matthew, if we continue reading, we'll see that God's perfect plan is getting ready to be fulfilled. Some of the disciples are close to denying Jesus. The emotional suffering has already been going on, but it's getting ready to get worse. And the physical pain is getting ready to begin. All of this is God's way of allowing us forgiveness of sin. We no longer needed animal sacrifices, a temple, or a high priest. Jesus will be our high priest. He is our mediator. The perfect Lamb of God was slain on the cross, a sinless sacrifice so that all of our sins could be forgiven once and for all. Christ suffered for us in many, many ways. And I know many of us think about those during our communion time. But he suffers so that we do not have to suffer eternal life without God. So as we commune around the Lord's table this morning, we need to focus and take just a minute and think about what the loaf and the cup truly means to us.
Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, again for the privilege of being here in your house this morning, this first day of the week, the Lord's Day. Lord, we ask that you bless our assembly this morning. We pray, Lord, for our preacher that as he comes to give us your word from your holy word, Lord, we ask that you bless him and give him a remembrance of the things he studied. Bless all of our sick, dear God. And be with those that stand in need, whatever that need may be. Thank you, Father, for Jesus. And I pray now for your blessing upon this loaf that represents the body of Christ. We know, Lord, from reading your word, that he came into the world and lived and died upon Calvary, that we, through him, might have eternal life. And we thank you for that. For we pray in Jesus' name.
Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you again for this Lord's Day you've given us. And we thank you, Father, for just being able to be in your house today and be in your presence and meet around your table. And Father, we just pray that you'll bless our time together today as we fellowship and just honor you and praise your name. And remember the love that you have for us and help us to love you as well. Father, we just pray that the message that Jerry delivers today will be uplifting to all of us and help us all to be drawn closer to you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. We know that he was the only and perfect sacrifice, the sacrifice without spot and blemish. the most perfect sacrifice that could take away the sins of the world. And you gave him to us, and he came to earth and suffered Calvary's cross and shed his blood there. Father, we know that blood is powerful, powerful enough to take away the sins of the world. And Father, we just pray that someone might accept you today as their Lord and Savior and be raised to walk a new creature in Christ and go home rejoicing today, and we will be rejoicing with them. And Father, we thank you for this cup, this emblem that represents the precious blood shed at Calvary's cross, and we just pray that you would be with each of us as we partake today. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
practical way of worshiping. Brittany Lyons will be sharing a message and song for us, and then also during this time, the children, the younger children, are dismissed to go to junior church.
Song is an oldie but a goodie, as they say, and I thought I had a very worthwhile message for what's going on in today's world, and Lord willing, the words are going to be up here on the screen, so if you do know it, or it's not very hard, so if you learn it, you can sing right along with me.
There are many people who will say they're Christians, and they live like Christians on the Sabbath day. But come Monday morning till the coming Sunday, they will fight their neighbor all along the way. If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor, don't love God. In the Holy Bible, in the book of Matthew, read the 18th chapter and the 21st verse. Jesus plainly tells us that we must have mercy. There's a special warning in the 35th verse. If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor, don't love God. There's a God Almighty, and you've got to love him if you want salvation and a home on high. If you say you love him while you hate your neighbor, then you don't have religion, you just told a lie. If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor, don't love God. If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor, don't love God. Then you don't love your neighbor, don't love God.
Thank you, Brittany. We'll look at somebody today who loves God. And we're going to continue in our sermon series from the book of Acts entitled Unleashed. So open your Bibles to Acts chapters 10 and 11. Last week we were in Acts chapter 9. We looked at the conversion of one man who God used to really change the world. That was Saul of Tarsus, who became better known as the great Apostle Paul. Today we're going to look at the conversion of another man, a Roman centurion named Cornelius, the first Gentile convert to Christianity. Now, I've often heard it said that we should be a witness for Jesus, and if necessary, use words. And it is true that people would rather see a sermon than hear one any day. But it is also true that words are necessary. Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Cornelius, like people everywhere, needed to hear the words of salvation. Do you remember the prophecy that Peter quoted in Acts chapter 2? He quoted from Joel chapter 2. And the prophecy was that God in the last days would pour out of his spirit upon all flesh. And in those days, all flesh was divided into two basic categories, Jewish flesh and Gentile flesh. And so God's spirit was poured out on Jewish flesh in Acts chapter 2 on the apostles of Jesus. And God's spirit is poured out on Gentiles' flesh in Acts chapter 10 on the household of Cornelius. And on both occasions, God used the apostle Peter to proclaim his message, the very words of salvation that God wanted people to hear. Now keep in mind that the church at this point had existed for like 7 to 10 years. Jews, Samaritans, and proselytes to Judaism had been evangelized, had been converted to Christ, had become a part of the kingdom of God, the church of Christ on earth. But up to this point, no Gentiles were in the church. God had to do something big, I mean really big, to get the Jewish Christians to see that God wanted Gentiles to be saved as well as them. And in Acts chapter 10, there are a series of miracles and visions that occur to get the gospel to the Gentiles. First of all, an angel appears to Cornelius and tells him to send for Peter. Secondly, Peter has a vision of unclean meats coming down from heaven on a sheet. And Peter is commanded to get up and to kill and eat that unclean meat. That vision is repeated 3 times. Thirdly, the Spirit of God tells Peter to go with the men who are appearing at the door downstairs while Peter is receiving this vision. The Spirit of God says, Peter, you go with those men. And fourthly, the baptism of the Holy Spirit occurs on the household of Cornelius while Peter is preaching the gospel to them. This was something that had not occurred since the church first began in Acts chapter 2. And then Peter and the Jews who were with him understand that God wanted Gentiles to be saved as well as them. And so Cornelius and his household are told, they are commanded to be baptized in water into Jesus Christ. Then in Acts chapter 11, Peter had to explain the events of Acts chapter 10 because the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem were very upset with Peter. They thought he shouldn't even eat with Gentiles, let alone preach the gospel to them and baptize them into Christ. And that brings us to our text in Acts 11, where Peter is defending himself and his actions before the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem. Acts 11, verses 12 through 18. Then the Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. Moreover, these 6 brethren accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house who said to him, send to Joppa and call for Peter, whose surname is Call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved. And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them as upon us at the beginning.
And then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If therefore God gave to them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to withstand God? When they heard these things, they became silent. And they glorified God, saying, then God has granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. Let's pray. Well, Father and God, we stand here before you today and in the company of many Gentiles, so thankful that you have granted unto us repentance to life. You have given us the opportunity to hear, to believe, and to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, the very words of our salvation. We have heard them, and we have believed them. We have embraced them. We have been saved by the power of the gospel. And we thank you so much that that good news of Jesus Christ coming to save sinners like us has been preached, has been taught, has been lived before us. We pray for those that are yet in their sin. Father, they'll take advantage of this opportunity today to embrace the gospel of Jesus Christ, our only hope, your only plan of salvation for sinners, Jews and Gentiles, no matter what race, what economic status, what political beliefs, what culture, what amount of education. The only hope we have is Jesus. Thank you for giving him to us. In his name we pray. Amen. I want you to notice again a key verse in our text from Acts 11. And that's verse 11. Acts 11, verse 14. Peter will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved. The entire historical account of the conversion of Cornelius emphasizes the importance of words. An angel of God had appeared to Cornelius in Acts 10 and told him to send for Peter for this reason. He will tell you words. He will tell you what you must do. And the men who came to get Peter told him that Cornelius was divinely instructed by a holy angel to bring Peter to his house to hear words from you. Acts 10:22. When Peter arrived at the household of Cornelius, Cornelius said to him, and I love this verse, it's Acts 10:33. Now therefore we are all present before God to hear all the things commanded you by God. And then again in chapter 10 and verse 44, while Peter was speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon them who heard the word. Words were necessary in Acts 10. Words were necessary in Acts chapter 2 when the gospel was first proclaimed. And words are still necessary today. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty. Teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words. Wonderful words. Wonderful words of life. And they were all so freely given, and they're wooing us to heaven. The wonderful words of life. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, for the message or the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Amen. 1 Corinthians 2:13 says, these things we speak, not in words which human wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches. It took the unleashed Word of God to convert you and me to Jesus Christ. And it took that same inspired message from God to convert the first Gentiles, the household of Cornelius, the first Gentiles to be saved by the gospel. But now let's consider more about this first Gentile convert, this man named Cornelius. What kind of man was he? Well, first of all, we see right away he was a God-fearing man. Acts 10 verses 1 and 2 says there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment, a devout man who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. Later in chapter 10, the men sent by Cornelius to get Peter said, Cornelius the centurion, he's a just man. He's one who fears God and has a good reputation among the nation of the Jews. He was a man who was loving his neighbor as himself. Now, but think about this for a moment. Most Roman soldiers hated Jews. I mean, they got their enjoyment out of mistreating and even killing Jewish people. The Romans liked doing that. But Cornelius, he was a different kind. He had a good reputation among the nation of the Jews. He respected the Jewish religion. He prayed to the Jewish God. He even gave financial gifts to the Jewish people. He put his money where his faith was. If you didn't know better, you might think he was already a Christian. And I just wonder today, what is your reputation in the neighborhood where you live? Would the people around you give a good report about you like they did about, like the Jewish people did about Cornelius? Never think, brothers and sisters, that our good deeds or lack thereof goes unnoticed by our community. And never think that our good deeds go unnoticed by God. Hebrews 6:10 says, God is not unjust to forget your work and your labor of love, which you have shown toward his name. Cornelius was a man with a good reputation, but Cornelius was not yet a Christian, and Cornelius was lost. Secondly, Cornelius was a praying man. He prayed to God always. The angel said to Cornelius, your prayer's been heard. Your alms are remembered in the sight of God. Now that brings up a question. Does God hear a sinner's prayer? And the answer is yes and no. Yes, he hears everything. He knows everything. Even things we think no one else knows, he knows. But does God promise to answer a sinner's prayer? No. He does not promise to answer their prayer. People who are in a covenant relationship with God have the privilege to talk to him in effective prayer. And after Jesus died on the cross, no one was told to pray to get saved. Sinners are told, like we studied last week, like Saul of Tarsus, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Then after we're saved, we have the privilege to pray for forgiveness and to pray for every other blessing of life we may need. And we should pray. We're commanded to pray. Pray without ceasing. We're admonished to worry about nothing, but to pray about everything. And we need to live like we pray. I knelt to pray when day was done and prayed, O Lord, bless everyone. Lift from every saddened heart the pain and let the sick be well again. And then I woke another day to carelessly go on my merry way. The whole day long, I did not try to wipe a tear from any eye. I did not try to share the load of any brother down the road. I did not even go to see the sick man right next door to me. And yet once again, when day was done, I prayed, O Lord, bless everyone. But as I prayed, into my ear there came a voice that whispered clear, pause, hypocrite. Before you pray, whom have you tried to bless today? God's sweetest blessings always go by hands that serve him here below. And then I hid my face and cried, forgive me, God. for I have lied. But let me live another day, and let me live the way I pray. Cornelius lived the way he prayed. He was a God-fearing man. He was a praying man. But nevertheless, he was a lost man. Thirdly, Cornelius was a Gentile. And Jews considered all Gentiles totally without hope. And indeed, Gentiles are still without hope, without Christ. Ephesians chapter 2 says, "Therefore remember that you also, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world." Those two verses in Ephesians 2 make it look very bad for Gentiles. But the next verse gives us great hope. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Cornelius, like all of us Gentiles, needed the blood of Christ. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus, my only hope. Fourthly, Cornelius was a centurion. That meant he had authority over 100 Roman soldiers. I'm reminded of another centurion that Luke writes about in his gospel account of the life of Christ. In Luke chapter 7, there was a centurion who had a servant who was very dear to him and was also very sick, sick even unto death. And that centurion sent men to Jesus, saying, "Lord, I am not worthy. I am not worthy that you should come under the roof of my house. But just say the word. Just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." And when Jesus heard these words, he marveled at him and turned around and said to the crowd that followed him, "I say to you, I have not found such a great faith. No, not in Israel have I found faith like this Gentile, this Roman centurion." And the servant was healed. Now, could that centurion have been Cornelius? Possibly. But probably not, because that centurion was in Capernaum and Cornelius was in Caesarea, many, many, many miles away. But both centurions had a common faith in Jesus. Both, or rather, a common faith in God. And both centurions were men of authority. Both centurions realized they had authority, but they had no authority over God. They realized they were under a higher authority. And all of us are under a higher authority. We are all under God. We are all under Christ. And Christ is the Lord of the church. He is the King of all kings. And it is to his authority that we all must submit. And that is true whether we sit on the Supreme Court and try to change the entire nation of the United States, or if we live in the White House. Whether we believe it or not, we are all under a higher authority, and we will all bow before Jesus Christ, the King of all. And because of our faith, we need to humbly bow before him now. What kind of man was Cornelius? He was a man who was willing to listen and to learn. Cornelius said, "I sent to you immediately, and you have done well to come to me. Now, therefore, we are all present before God to hear all the things commanded you by God." Don't you love the attitude of this man? This guy is a Roman centurion, and he humbly sits down before this fisherman, Peter, who is truly fishing for men now. And he says, we just want to hear what God has, what God wants you to say to us. We want to hear it. We want to hear all of it. How many people have we met down through the years who are so arrogant you cannot tell them anything? You can't tell me. Why? Why can't you tell them something? Because they already know it all. You start to tell them, oh, don't tell me that. I already know that. Oh, yeah, I know that too. You try to tell them, oh, I know that. No. You try to teach them something about, oh, no, I already know that. I've already studied that. You can't tell me nothing. Why is it that people are like that? What is behind that attitude? It's pride. And pride goes before destruction, but humility goes before salvation. 1 Peter 5:6 says, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. That was Cornelius. He was a man of authority, but he did not let it go to his head. More important than his authority was his humility. And because of his humility, Cornelius was a man willing to believe. Look at part of Peter's sermon. Oh, it's a beautiful sermon. Just going to read a couple verses of it, about five. Acts 10:38. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging him on a tree. Him, God, raised up on the third day and showed him openly, not to all people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that it is he who was ordained by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever believes in him will receive remission of sins. Now obviously, Cornelius and his household believe this message. For while they are listening, the Holy Spirit is poured out upon them, as it was poured out on the apostles back in Acts chapter 2. That would have never happened to unbelievers. But it wasn't enough just to believe. Cornelius was also a man who was willing to obey. Let's read the rest of the chapter. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. And those of the circumcision who believed were astonished, as many as who came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. And then Peter answered, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. The pouring out of the Holy Spirit upon the Gentiles was the same thing that happened to the apostles back in the beginning, back in Acts chapter 2. So this was another special occasion. People were not baptized in the Holy Spirit every time people got saved. Look at what Peter says about this occasion in Acts 11, going back to our text. He said, as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them as on us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So Peter identifies what happened to the household of Cornelius as what happened to the apostles at the beginning. So it was not something that was happening every day or every Sunday or every month. This was a sign. This was a sign to show Peter and the other Jews God wanted Gentiles in the church. They still had to be baptized in water to be saved. Now, you don't have to be a Bible scholar to figure this out, but you do have to study the Scriptures. You do have to study. And then it will become clear to you. Here's the point. Cornelius was willing to obey. and he was baptized into Christ. And now what about you? You may be God-fearing. No doubt you are. You're in church today. It's Labor Day weekend. What are you doing in church? You're God-fearing. You may be praying. You may pray every day. You may pray a lot. You may be giving. You may be a very generous giver. But if you have not obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, you are lost in your sin. Today, if you are willing to believe and obey, you can be saved. And there is no other way to be saved but to trust and obey Jesus. There is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey Him. And so please don't wait on another miracle. Please don't wait too late. For now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And so I conclude our message this morning with the words, the unleashed words of the Apostle Peter in Acts 2 and verse 38. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. We invite you to do that while we stand and sing. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a not a sign or a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way and obey. It is Labor Day weekend, and we're glad that you chose to be in the house of the Lord today. And not all of our members are gone for the weekend to do whatever. We've got four of our members that are gone to preach the gospel in other places. So Bobby, Brian, Josh, and Aaron, they're preaching in four different congregations. Two in Kentucky, one in West Virginia, and one in South Carolina. So they're preaching the gospel, and Bobby will be back here tonight and bring our evening message. We've got officers and ladies meetings this afternoon at 5 and the evening service tonight at 6. So hopefully you can be back. Thanks for being here and your good attention. Anything else we need to announce before we're dismissed? Okay, if not, I'd like to ask Brother Randy Mullins to lead us in our closing prayer.